Hey there, this is your host, Dr. Lori Friesen, and you're listening to episode number 23 of Beginning Teacher Talk. Just because you're a beginning elementary teacher, there is no need for you to struggle like one. I'm dedicated to being the mentor for you that I wish I had when I first started teaching. In this podcast, we talk about all of the behind-the-scenes stuff about teaching you really need to know but didn't learn when you were in university. And we share the most amazing resources, tips, and strategies out there so you can become the teacher you've always dreamed of being. Let's start the show. Welcome back. Again, this is your host, Dr. Lori Friesen, and as always, I am thrilled that you have chosen to spend some of your very precious time with me here today, especially because we are going to talk about such an incredibly important topic. Today, we're going to talk about something that I have had so many new teachers reach out and ask me about. It's crazy. I have so many teachers saying, "What can I do to get ready for this school year when I can only get into my classroom 1 week before school starts?" Crazy. So first of all, just for the record, I think it's insanely unfair to ask teachers to be ready to teach elementary school when you're only given 1 week to be in your classroom before school starts. However, this actually isn't as much of a problem as you might think, because there are actually a lot of things you can do, and I would argue should do, that you don't need to be in your classroom in order to accomplish. Now, before we begin, I just want to do a warm shout out to my Ready for School Academy members who are, as we speak, successfully completing my 5-step process for truly being ready for their year of teaching. They are working so hard and so diligently, and I am just super proud and genuinely honored to be part of this journey with them. So if you're one of my Ready for School Academy members and you're listening right now, I just want you to know that I am so proud of the amazing work that you are doing. I created the Ready for School Academy so that elementary teachers in their first few years of teaching would not have to experience the isolation and the overwhelm that I experienced when I first started teaching, and that I know that so many other new teachers experience as they work to get ready for their school year and just don't know what to do next. Now, I closed enrollment on this program on July 24th, so it's too late to join this year, but I will let you know the moment I open the doors for next year's group. So even though I can't invite you into the academy right now, today I have a very special treat for you, because I'm going to walk you through, step by step, 14 things that I would do right away if I were in the situation of not being able to get into my classroom until 1 week before school starts. And these are all things that you can do to ensure that you are ready for this school year, no matter what. So to make this easier for you, I've divided these 14 items into two sections. Section number one is physical classroom decor and classroom organization. And section number two is planning and classroom management preparation. So let's walk through each of these two sections in detail and talk specifically about what you can do to prepare if you're in this situation. And even if you're not, even if you're just getting ready for the school year and you have access to your classroom right now, these are all things that you can be doing right now to help ensure that you're ready for the school year. So let's start with physical classroom decor and classroom organization, because this seems to be one of the biggies that many of you have told me you're very concerned about. So I'm going to share some very simple and effective ways that you can plan out your physical classroom space even before you actually get access to it. Now, number one, I would see if you can get in just to see the space and take pictures of everything so that you don't have to work from memory when you're working on this from home. And you don't actually even really have to ask permission to go and see your new classroom. Here's what I would do, and by the way, what I have done when I was in the same situation you're in now. I wasn't able to get into my classroom yet because they were cleaning. But I just went to my new school during the daytime hours to see if anyone was there. And when I saw someone, I just tapped on the front door. And when they came to answer it, I just told them who I was, that I was a new teacher at the school, and I just wanted to see the classroom that I was assigned to so I could kind of plan for it. And I explained I just wanted 15 minutes to see my classroom and take some measurements so that I could begin to prepare for the school year. And most of the custodial staff, and especially the secretary, if she's already there, are pretty compassionate about wanting to help new teachers. So I think they saw the desperation on my face and they knew that I genuinely just wanted 15 minutes to get in there and kind of get a scope for the space. And when they see that you're not a crazy person and you don't actually want to get in to start setting up, they're usually pretty good about giving you just a bit of time to get in and see the space. So just be bold about asking and then show your genuine gratitude and relief about getting in to see your room. And generally speaking, people will be pretty generous with you and, you know, they'll take some pity on you when you're in this situation. And that's what happened when I was in that situation. The custodian let me in and said, but you have to promise you only get, you know, 20 minutes and don't step, you know, on the areas that we've just cleaned. So, you know, I had to make a deal with the custodian, but they were really sweet. And by the way, if there's no one there on the first day, try again. You aren't asking for anything unreasonable. Just keep trying to see if there's anyone at the school and stopping by. And as long as you aren't looking like a stalker or like peeking in windows or something weird, there shouldn't be a problem with you just getting in to check out the space. Now, if you're able to get into your classroom, even just for 15 minutes, bring a measuring tape and a notebook and measure your bulletin boards, as well as the height of the inside of storage spaces like shelves and cabinets in your room, so that you can go ahead and order any storage solutions you want, like book bins and storage bins. So again, take pictures of all of the spaces, the wall spaces, the physical space, of any furniture that you have in the room. Take lots of pictures and then measure bulletin boards and any storage spaces where you might want to buy storage solutions. Those are the two things I would do. And then number two, when you get home, look at your photos and draw just a simple aerial map of your classroom so you can start mapping out where you want to put things in your room and how you might want to organize the different spaces in your classroom. So that's going to help you to think through the flow of your space, and it'll give you an idea of what kinds of furniture you might need to ask your school for if they can provide it, or alternatively, what you can start searching secondhand stores for and garage sales for. That was a biggie for me when I first started teaching. I spent a lot of my first summer before I started teaching searching for all sorts of treasures at garage sales and in secondhand stores. It's amazing what a fresh coat of paint can do for like an old cabinet or an old storage space. So check those places out if you're looking for furniture. You can also ask your administration in advance about getting access to certain kinds of furniture you really want for your room. So if there are bookcases that you'd really like or need, or a round table for group work, or a kidney-shaped table for small group work, as well as a carpet for the entire class to gather on. So ask for these things early, and if the school has any access to those materials, usually not carpets, but usually furniture, before the busy school year starts, it can be a lot more effective than trying to get everything you need once everyone else is there and asking for everything that they need as well. Now, even if you can't get into your space to see it, honestly, most classrooms are just a rectangular shape anyways. So making an aerial map of how you would kind of want to set up your room is still a great thing to do, so you can think through what kinds of spaces you want to create and how you want to set up your desks and different areas of your room. So number three, you can also begin collecting books for your classroom library and then start organizing them according to either level, theme, or topic. It just depends on how you want to organize your library. There's no right answer here because it just depends on your philosophy with teaching children how to read. Some schools are really into leveling books and some schools swear that off as being a terrible thing to do. So whatever is kind of aligned with your own teaching philosophy and the school that you're teaching with might be how you're going to choose to organize your classroom books. So you'll want to purchase some cheap book bins and label them for your class library. Dollar stores online have lots of great options for this. And by the way, if you're looking for ways to get cheap or free books, check out the podcast episode number 16 I did, where I share 16 cheap, free, and creative ways to get books for your classroom library. So I'll link to that one for you in the show notes. All right. So step number four, go ahead and download the ultimate back to school shopping list I've created for you and do some shopping. Take advantage of some of the awesome back to school specials that are on now, because buying supplies later in the year is going to be a lot more expensive. But just a word of caution, don't go overboard. Like, don't buy too much. Your students are going to be bringing most of their own supplies on the first day of school. Instead, I would recommend that you just buy extras of anything that's on for a really great deal. So if you run out of something like glue sticks, that's a big one. I always buy extra glue sticks at the beginning of the year, or crayons, or markers. Markers can be a big one too, as long as you can store them somewhere where they won't dry out. Then you'll have some extras to tie you over if you run out of them in the middle of the year, until you can ask parents to send more to school. So go ahead and download that free ultimate back to school shopping list and do some shopping now. And again, I'll link to that freebie in the show notes for this episode. Number five, invest in some great classroom labels that you love from Teachers Pay Teachers. There's so many options on Teachers Pay Teachers, and start organizing and labeling all of your supplies in the storage containers that you've purchased to keep them in throughout the year. So that way, when you finally move into your classroom, it'll just be a matter of figuring out where you want to store your supplies that are all ready to go. So again, you want to be labeling all of your supplies in storage containers. Hopefully you've been able to get into your classroom to measure the height of storage options for your classroom. But even if you haven't, I mean, even just buying some basic storage options, you'll find a place for them in your classroom. So I would go ahead and buy some storage options. And by that, I mean like bins and different things to store different materials in, because you can always find a good cabinet for them to go in later. Okay, so that's step number five. Step number six, I would suggest that bulletin boards do not need to become the time-sucking black hole that they seem to become for so many teachers. So my advice is to just choose 2 to 3 colors that you love and buy flannel-backed tablecloths and borders in those colors so that you can alternate them throughout your space. So just choose 1 or 2 designs to get you started, 1 or 2 colors to get you started. And that's something you can add to throughout the year. You don't have to do all of your bulletin boards at the beginning of the year. And you can fill them up with student work during the first week of school. So don't stress too much about this. So again, just 2 to 3 colors, alternate borders and backgrounds, and you'll be good to go. And then, you know, a couple of really great titles for your bulletin boards. But keep it simple. You don't need to do too much with this. And step number seven, finally, get your class list and make name cards for student desks, for their mailboxes, and for their backpack and jacket hooks. So that way you've got everything, all of your labels ready to go, regardless of, you know, when you get into your classroom. You could do this the day before school if you needed to. Also, remember to keep extras of all of these types of name cards and keep them in a place where you can easily find them, because chances are your class list is going to change numerous times in the first month or two of school. So you'll need to be able to make new name cards easily. So again, keep extras of all of the name cards and make sure they're easily accessible for you. Okay, so now let's talk about part two of what you can do if you can't get into your classroom until 1 week before school starts. The planning and classroom management preparation that you'll need to do and can do without even stepping foot into your classroom. So number one, I would suggest that you choose your teacher planning binder and customize and print it. Unless you're using an online planner, then you'll want to customize it online. So getting your planning binder ready now is essential to preparing for a successful school year. I'm still old school. I love to have a physical binder because I like to be able to take it wherever I go and bring it home with me if I need to. And I just like having a physical binder. But this is where you can keep whether you do it digital or physical. You can keep all of your calendars, your schedules, your lesson plans, your curriculum maps, your meeting notes, and your pacing guides all in one place so that you can easily pull it out each week when you go to plan. Secondly, find out when your class specials are. So if you have gym or physical education or library or art classes or whatever it is that are your school's or your grade level's class specials, find out when they are and find out how much instructional time is required for each subject area. And then create your weekly class schedule. So once you kind of get an idea of, I need so many periods of language arts per week, I need so many periods of whatever it is, all of your subject areas, create your weekly class schedule. Number three, familiarize yourself with the curriculum for your grade level and ask for any pacing guides that your school might provide or that your grade level team would be willing to share, and then get started working on your year plans. Now, don't go into too much detail with planning because, man, things can change very quickly in terms of resources that are available to you and in terms of district-wide adoption of curriculum. So I would recommend that you not plan too far ahead right now. Just paint your year in broad strokes. And believe me, I can tell you this from experience. I remember my first year of teaching second grade, I had spent a lot of my summer taking home curriculum resources for each subject area and planning out my units, only to find out in September that our school was going to pilot an entirely new language arts program beginning in October. So all of that time I'd spent planning really cool units was wasted. And I hear this from teachers all the time. Many times districts make, I don't know if they're spontaneous decisions or if they just don't tell us about it until the last minute, but it happens a lot. So again, just find out what your administration requires in terms of plans that you're going to be asked to hand in, and then just plan your year plans in broad strokes for now. Okay, number four, instead of making detailed unit plans, use this time to plan for your first week of school. That means getting crystal clear about your classroom management plan. So this is a great time to think through which rules, routines, and class jobs you want to have in your classroom, and think through how and when you want to teach them. Now, if you haven't already downloaded my Ultimate Classroom Management Starter Kit, you may want to do that to help you to think through and outline what you need to prepare for this first week of school. And again, I'll link to that in the show notes for this episode. So if you're out at the gym or aren't anywhere where you can actually write all of this down or click on it right away, you can get it all in the show notes after. So preparing for your first week of school also means getting super clear about what kinds of getting to know you activities you'll want to do with your students. And again, I have another fantastic free resource available to you called 10 Fantastic First Week of School Activities that you can download and use right away. So you will be really well set up for all of this. Again, all of these freebies are available in the show notes for this episode. So you can go ahead and download whatever you need. At step number five, finally, it isn't too early to start thinking through what you want to do on Meet the Teacher Night. This evening is a fantastic opportunity to get parents involved from the beginning of the school year and to be able to communicate everything that you want parents to know about how you will communicate with them and involve them as partners in their child's learning throughout the school year. Now, if you haven't listened to last week's episode where I walk you through step by step how to prepare for Meet the Teacher Night, you might want to go back and listen to that episode as well to ensure that you have everything you need to be ready for that important night. And number six, finally, my last piece of advice to you is to be kind to yourself. Now, I know you hear this all the time, but I hope you take this to heart. From someone who has been in the classroom for more than 10 years or taught in the classroom for more than 10 years, keep things simple and remember that your classroom is a work in progress. You'd never decorate a room in your house in only 1 week, right? It takes time to figure out all of the perfect things that you want to do when you're redecorating an entire room. So be patient and kind with yourself in terms of your classroom decorations and in how you're setting up that space. Remember that this is a process, and how your students use the space is really going to teach you about improvements you can make and how you can shift it. So whatever you think your classroom is going to look like now, it's probably going to change based on the students that you get. It's always different every year. So, and you can continue to work on it throughout the year. So there's no need to have it fully done on the first day. Also, it's really nice for your students to be able to participate in the process of making the room beautiful. Remember, it's their room just as much as it's your room. So that first day, you can share the story about how you were only able to get into your classroom 1 week ago and, you know, how freaked out you were about it. But then tell them you need their help to make this a great place for them to come to every day. You could even have a brainstorming session with your students to talk about ideas they have for making their classroom beautiful, and then tell them that you know the very best way to make this classroom amazing is to fill it with their fabulous work. So during those first few days of school, do some great getting to know you activities that you can put on display and that will allow students to leave their mark on this new space. Also, you could have a bit of fun with this by putting a large sign on one or two of your bulletin boards that says, "Surprise coming soon," and then let students guess what might be displayed on that bulletin board. All right, so there you have it. Those are 14 ways you can prepare for your year of teaching, even if you can't get into your classroom until 1 week before school starts. I hope that this information has been helpful for you as you begin to prepare for your school year, and I really hope that you'll tune in again next week, because I'm going to be talking about another very important topic that we just don't pay enough attention to. And it's this: how to practice self-care at school so that you don't get sick at the start of the year. Now, I'm not going to tell you things like book a massage, because we all know that very few of us will actually do that anyways, even though we really want to. I'm going to share you instead some very practical, smart tips and ideas for how you can take care of yourself while you're teaching and doing all of those amazing things that you're doing for students. So this is going to be all about how to intentionally take care of yourself while you're teaching. And I really don't want you to miss this. I really wish someone would have shared this with me when I first started teaching. So I'm thrilled to be passing it on to you now. All right. I hope you have a wonderful week. And remember, just because you're a beginning elementary teacher, there is no need for you to struggle like one. Bye for now.